Erev Tov Chavrim, I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live, September 19th, 2017. It's the evening time right now. And before we get into the breaking stories that are continually developing right now with North Korea and that of Syria and the tensions between the United States and Russia, wanted to quickly mention the video that we did just the other day about the Revelation 12 sign. The Revelation 12 sign, many people are looking at this as being a possible rapture time coming up, some believing that this is the Jubilee year, that it would fall here on Yom Kippur, the Feast of Atonement. And as we did our video, we were doing this video in regards to being the last Jubilee and how that would relate to Isaiah 61, the two witnesses, etc. But I did want to make something clear, because I've seen several comments out there saying, Steve, you know, when in 6 days from now, we will see that you were wrong. I am not saying there is a rapture in 7 days or on September 23rd or September 30th. And I am not saying that this is the year of Jubilee. I do want to make that very clear. What it was for me is the revelation that I got regarding what the last Jubilee would actually be. So whenever the last Jubilee is, certainly I do believe that the two witnesses will come on the scene. I do not believe, though, either that it is Donald Trump and Prime Minister Netanyahu. Neither one of them. No, I don't believe that either. Appreciate if you believe that, that's perfectly okay. But do understand, as far as, is there going to be a rapture September 23rd or sometime between there and the 30th? That's not my opinion. I have no idea when God will do or what he will do. So I just want to make sure I'm very clear and not misunderstood, because to me it was an incredible message that the Lord laid upon my heart. But because of the situation with the Revelation 12 sign, as so many people are excited about, and because of those saying this is the last Jubilee, I don't know that it's the last Jubilee. I wanted to clarify that, and not for people to go around thinking that, well, Steve prophesied that this is going to be the rapture and the time of the catching away, etc. I did not. And so I wanted to clarify that with you guys. Let's get into right into the news here that's going on this evening, because it's a very serious situation. We often speak of on the program I'm on Hebrew Nation Radio with Bonnie Harvey, we call it the flashpoint. And always we're looking to see what would be the flashpoint that could ignite the world into a world war. And I'm seeing two places as of right now that are definitely keeping the headlines going. And right now, the hottest place I can think of is Syria. I know some people might think that it's North Korea, with some of the things that President Trump said today in the, his address at the United Nations. But in reality, I'm watching very close what's happening in Syria. As we've already mentioned to you, the Russians have, but the Syrians have crossed the Euphrates River. It was a red line that the U.S. said for them not to cross. And since then, the strongest attacks coming against the Syrian military as they've crossed the Euphrates River is not coming from ISIS, but rather U.S.-backed coalition fighters there in the region, and very troubling. In fact, another interesting report, just to kind of show you guys, we're not the only ones that are realizing that this is completely wrong, what's happening. Ron Paul, the Ron Paul Institute, he's also reporting on this, as his article says, the U.S. has a new red line in Syria, and it is ridiculous. It's written by Darius, and says here, in its latest breach of the international law, the U.S. is unilaterally attempting to prevent the Syrian government from reclaiming its own territory. From Reuters, they said this here, U.S.-backed Syrian militants will not let government forces cross the Euphrates River in their bid to recover eastern Syria, their commander said on Friday, but Russia said army units had already done so near the city of Deir el-Zor. Reuters notes that the Russia is involved in the particular part of Syria, bolstering the Syrian Arab army and its allies with air power. Now, again, this is Ron Paul on his site, the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity. You know, he is a former congressman, and you know, I think he has a very valid point, and I appreciate that as well. Now, let's just real quick look at the map here. This is from a Russian site where it's also speaking about the exact same thing. Even in your title here, they're talking about you know, how that the Syrian army is coming under attack by the U.S.-backed rebels there that are here in the north. Now, If you can see on your screen here, you can see the river, the Euphrates River, coming down. This is the heart of the city. And on the western side of the river, the Syrian Arab army here in red, they have taken everything. They've closed in, closed ISIS off right here. And they went across down here further south and have crossed the river. This is where Russia went in there and the Syrian Arab Air Force. They bombed heavily. ISIS that were there fled to the north here. The yellow here is where the Free Syrian Army and the Kurds are moving in as well to try to take this region. This whole region is very rich in oil, and it's one of the reasons why there is such a major fight for this region. And according to the Syrian Arab Army on the ground, they are getting a lot of shelling that is coming from that northern part there. Now, I think we have, let me see if we still have that or not there. Yes, I think this is it right here. This is where some of the shelling is going on right here that was happening with them. We'll kill the volume on this here, where the bombing is coming in from this region from the U.S. coalition forces there. So it's very troubling what's happening here to see that the Syrian government is not being allowed to take back their own territory, but instead the U.S. is only moving ISIS out of the way for their own prosperity in the region there. Very troubling indeed. Also, another thing I want to bring out as well, this article right here that came out was actually all in Arabic originally, and troubling again. What do we see here? We have a British representative here with the Saudis, and they are cooperating, doing an agreement to cooperate on military and security fields between the two countries. It's letting us know that something is majorly getting ready to happen in the Middle East there. And we've already talked about yesterday about how the Saudis under Kushner, and this, of course, this was back in May, everybody knows some old news to begin with, was working on a secret deal with the Saudis to try to help them to get long-range missiles as well as nuclear-capable missiles to deal with the Iranians. So what's going to happen is really interesting. We know the U.S. has built a base in Israel. Again, I appreciate the U.S. standing up for Israel in a time of such a desperate time. But at the same time, as I've stated before, with a bit of caution, because I can see this, that this is Rome moving in, making sure they can get eventually a United Nations force inside of Israel as well in order to be able to take over Jerusalem. It's only a matter of time, friends. So what may appear to be good in the interim is not always the best in the long run. Also going on right here, Trump calls for North Korea's regime, and this is where he's talking about to be totally destroyed. I can understand removing Kim Jong-un. I can understand trying to find a way to put a stop to this man's nuclear ability. I do agree that there could be more done that could be done in a peaceful manner. But unfortunately, all these war games on somebody's doorstep is only going to cause them to respond as well. Listen to what President Trump has to say in this particular case here. Let me make sure we have our volume up on this. We do. And to hear what he says here at the United Nations.
The United States has great strength and patience. But if it is forced to defend itself or its allies, we will have no choice but to totally destroy North Korea. Rocket Man is on a suicide mission for himself and for his regime. The United States is ready, willing, and able. But hopefully, this will not be necessary.
Now, the troubling point in this to begin with is the fact that, one, as he mentions, he calls him Rocket Man, and that just being the fact that the U.S. is willing to use this type of lethal force only because he is test firing his rockets. It is kind of a trade-off, so to speak. The United States continues to do the drills on its border. China and Russia both have asked the U.S. to curtail some of these military drills that are going on North Korea's border so that it would give more room for negotiations. Even the South Korean president has also called for this. But unfortunately, doesn't look like it's going to go that way in the long run. Very troubling indeed. And then I also saw this tweet here by Waleed. He tweeted this with Morgan Freeman. And I just thought it was interesting that this particular tweet came out and what Morgan Freeman had to say here. He's definitely indicting President Putin and calling upon swift action against Russia, so to speak, here in a roundabout way. Very troubling. But keep in mind, of course, Morgan Freeman was a strong Hillary supporter. So just kind of watch what happens here. Just do this in closing.
We have been attacked. We are at war. Imagine this movie script. A former KGB spy, angry at the collapse of his motherland, plots a course for revenge. Taking advantage of the chaos, he works his way up through the ranks of a post-Soviet Russia and becomes president. He establishes an authoritarian regime. Then he sets his sights on his sworn enemy, the United States. And like the true KGB spy he is, he secretly uses cyber warfare to attack democracies around the world. Using social media to spread propaganda and false information, he convinces people in democratic societies to distrust their media, their political processes, even their neighbors. And he wins. Vladimir Putin is their spy, and this is no movie script. We need our president to speak directly to us and tell us the truth. We need him to sit behind the desk in the Oval Office and say, my fellow Americans, during this past election, we came under attack by the Russian government. I've called on Congress and our intelligence community to use every resource available to conduct a thorough investigation to determine exactly how this happened. The free world is counting on us for leadership. For 241 years, our democracy has been a shining example to the world.
I guess the one thing that was troubling most to me is not so much that Russia or even the United States do not get involved in other people's election espionage, spying the entire world is like that. Every country has its own spy network, its own involvement in the internet, sabotage or whatever. They're all guilty of it. There's no difference between Russia or the United States or any other country for that matter. But one thing that I did notice, though, that Morgan Freeman said in this video that I thought was interesting is that we should be trusting our media. I guess that means CNN and Fox and all the rest, all the propaganda that comes to the United States. We're supposed to trust that and forget about social media or alternative media. That's really the outcome of his message. That's troubling. I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live.